Jesus Christ. Good morning. It's great to see you all this morning. Good to be together. Welcome to this service of worship. We're thrilled to have you all here and hope you will stay for lunch and fellowship. It's good to be together. Welcome to visitors. If you have not been here before, or even if you have, we are so glad to have you, welcome you in the name of Christ, ask you to fill out a little card there in the pews so that we can greet you and get to know you. A special welcome to Marilyn Suber, who is here from New Hope Presbyterian Church. She's a friend of the presbytery, and we're so glad to have you worshiping with us. So a special welcome to you and any others who we haven't seen in a while or who may be visiting. Special thanks to Reverend Stephanie Hill for being with us this morning. It's really nice to see her reconnecting with many of you. She was a pastor? Parish associate for about 4 years, and her daughter is here with her. So welcome, glad to have you here. And I look forward to Stephanie's bringing the word, our message this morning. You'll see in the announcements that August 25th, we will have a congregational meeting, so please be advised of that. We'll do that right after worship for the purpose of electing officers to the officer nominating committee. Rick's gonna say something about that in just a minute. The session meeting is not today, it will be next week. And wanted to say thank you to the deacons. We had a wonderful picnic Wednesday evening, a good time to be together, had some great food and a good time with the men from the shelter and each other. And I'd like to add Heath Snodgrass to our prayer list. Heath had some surgery this week and is recovering at home and doing well, Nancy says, but want to keep him in prayer. So please add him to the list. And I think that's all I have. And Rick wants to share a little bit about Officer Nominating Committee.
Thank you. You know about the congregational meeting on the 25th. That's when we will elect the other three members of the Officer Nominating Committee. The handout that was in your bulletin last week, and I thought was going to be in the bulletin this week, it gives you the actual job description of the Officer Nominating Committee and how it's laid out. And since there's been some questions and how all that works, we said last week, and I hope it's in the bulletin this week, if you have any questions about how this whole process works with the Officer Nominating Committee and then the Pastor Nominating Committee and then the election of officers, how that fits together, just stick around right down here for just a few minutes after church today, and we'll try to very informally answer some questions you might have. Bobby Martin is the deacon representative on the committee this year, and Natasha and I are the two elder representatives on the Officer Nominating Committee. So there is an envelope in the church office. You can put names in there if you're asking people to be on the Officer Nominating Committee. We ask that you check with them ahead of time so that they have agreed to do so. We will have a written ballot on the 25th, and anybody who is nominated needs to have ahead of time agreed to serve. So we'll go over that a little bit more later, but get your nominations in. We'll close the random nominations for that envelope by next Sunday, because we're going to print a ballot up. But in the Presbyterian Church, you can always nominate from the floor. You can always nominate from the floor for any election that we have. So thank you, and if you have any questions, just stick around for a minute, and we'll informally talk about it and answer your questions today after church. Thank you.
Thank you. you wish to follow along, page 592 in your pew Bible. This is the vision of Isaiah, son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Pekahiah, who were kings of Judah. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Listen to the teaching of our God, you people of Gomorrah. What to me is the multitude of your sacrifices, says the Lord. I've had enough of burnt offerings of rams, and the fat of fed beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or of goats. When you come to appear before me, who asked this from your hand? Trample my courts no more. Bringing offerings is futile. Incense is an abomination to me. New moon and Sabbath are calling of convocation. I cannot endure solemn assemblies with iniquity. Your new moons and your appointed festival my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you stretch out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do good. Seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. Come now, let us argue it out, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be like snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured by the sword. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. The gospel calls us to turn away from sin and to live into the grace of Christ as we offer ourselves to God in penitence and faith. We renew our confidence and trust in God's mercy. Let us join together in the prayer of confession, knowing that even before we confess, we have been forgiven. Please join me. Our gracious God, Jesus taught us to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Jesus taught us to love our neighbors as ourselves. Jesus taught us to trust you completely. We confess that we have often failed to learn, and what we have learned, we have often failed to put into practice. Forgive us, we pray, in the name of Jesus, the great teacher. Amen. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. May we forgive as we have so been forgiven.
This is from the New Testament, page 211. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For we look forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, he received power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one is good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven, and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed, and they were strangers and foreigners on the earth. For people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they left behind, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you.
please come up. Oh, she wants to sit beside you, Maddie. Can you make some room, girl? There you go. Well, good morning. It is so good to see you all. Some of you were just little kids. Okay, I'll let you see it in just a minute. Can I have it right now? Okay, and when I'm done, I'll let you say something. Okay. So, some of you were just itty-bitty the last time I was here, and now you're like all like almost adults and all grown up. And so it's really great to see the new generation of little ones here. So I have a question for you. Let's pretend for a second I have a box of coloring crayons in my hand. What is your favorite color in that box? Tell me, what's your favorite color?
Red.
Red, that's a good one. Yours is red too? What about the rest of you? Who has a different favorite color than red? Yes. What's yours? Am I gonna reach? Am I gonna do it? Yep.
Purple.
Purple, that's a good one. What about you? What's your favorite?
Pink.
Pink, that's a good one. What about you?
Mine is pink.
Pink too, okay. We got some pink, we got some purple, we got some red, we got, what else do we got? Yellow. Pink, I know, blue. Okay, so my next question, what do you like to color with those colors? Yes. Rainbows, okay, what do you like? Okay. What's your favorite?
Pink and gold.
Gold, that's a good one. Okay, so we got rainbows, we got, what else do we like to color? Yeah, we like to make comics. Is that a, or? Okay, so we like to use our imaginations, army man suits. What else do we like to color with those colors? Yes.
Purple fluffy unicorns.
Yeah, purple fluffy unicorns. That's really awesome. What else do you like to color?
Pink rainbow.
Yeah, okay, and one more.
Dogs.
Dogs, yes. So, and cats, yep. Okay, so what if in my box of crayons, I took out your favorite color and said that that color was no longer gonna be in the box? How would that make you feel? Happy, sad, yeah, because your favorite color wasn't in there anymore, right? So you couldn't make purple fluffy unicorns, and you couldn't do rainbows, and you couldn't draw dogs and make the army costumes. It would be super sad, right? Yeah, or you could use a different color, but it would be sad to not have your favorite color in this box. Well, I'm gonna read a scripture in a little while from 1 Corinthians, and in that, we hear that God created the church, created all of us, the body of Christ, to kind of be like that box of crayons. And we are all unique and special, and we are all necessary, because if any one of us wasn't in there, then the world would miss out on something really cool. The church would miss out on being able to do something really cool. And so what I want you to go from here today, thinking about and remembering, is that you are all special, and you are all needed in this body, and you are all wonderfully made, and you are all part of something, a big, beautiful picture that is being created for this world. So let's thank God together. Let's say a prayer. Please join me. Dear God, I thank you for each and every one of these children. I thank you for creating them special, for making them bright and wonderful and vibrant. And I ask that the portrait that you paint with each and every one of their lives be gorgeous and beautiful and wondrous. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Okay. One, what do you want to say?
Go.
I got white.
Okay.
Good morning. It is an honor and a privilege to be back with you this morning. I'm going to shorten up my scripture a little. I'm going to start with verse 12 this morning. Hear the good news. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews and Greeks, slave or free, and all were made to drink of one Spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the organs in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single organ, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need for you, nor again the head to the foot, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body which seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those parts of the body which we think less have less honor. which we think less honorable, we invest with greater honor. And our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has so adjusted the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior parts, that there may be no discord in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Now, you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then workers of miracles, then healers, helpers, administrators, speakers in various types of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the higher gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way. I'm going to start with a letter from Dear Andrew. Dear Andrew, I'm writing because I just can't deal with my father anymore. He's a 65-year-old super right-wing conservative who has basically turned into a total jerk, intent on ruining our relationship and our planet with his politics. I'm more or less a liberal Democrat with very progressive values, and I know that people like my dad are going to destroy us all. I don't have any good times with him anymore. All we do is argue. When I try to spend time with him without talking politics or discussing any current events, there's still an underlying tension that makes it really uncomfortable. Don't get me wrong, I love him, no matter what, but how do I explain to him that his politics are turning him into a monster, destroying the environment, and pushing away the people who care about him? Thanks for your help, son of a right-winger. Dear son of a right-winger, go back and read the opening sentences of your letter. Read them again. Then read the rest of your letter. Then read it again. Try to find a single instance where you referred to your dad as a human being, a person, or a man. There isn't one. You've reduced your father, the person who created you, to a set of beliefs and political views and how it relates to you. And you don't consider your dad a person of his own standing. He's just your dad. And you've also reduced yourself to a set of opposing views and reduced your relationship with him to a fight between the two. The humanity has been reduced to nothingness, and all that's left in its place is an argument that can never really be won. And even if one side did win, it probably wouldn't satisfy the deeper desire to be in a state of inflamed, passionate conflict. The world isn't being destroyed by Democrats or Republicans, red or blue, liberal or conservative, religious or atheist. The world is being destroyed by one side, believing that the other side is destroying the world. The world is being hurt and damaged by one group of people, believing they're truly better people than the others who think differently. The world officially ends when we let our beliefs conquer love. We must not let this happen. On a recent trip to Disney World, I noticed that the parking lot had been divided into two sections, heroes and villains. This way, at the end of a long day of fun, it would be easy to remember what tram to take back to my car, either the villain tram or the hero tram. How easy is that? Just two options, no fuzzy gray area, hero, villain. And then I turn on the news, or I read Facebook, or a Dear Andrew letter, or I listen to a conversation, or I participate in a conversation, and I started to notice the same classifications being used. Villain, or hero. And there has to be a better way. The world officially ends when we let our beliefs conquer love, says Andrew. I wish these divisions and judgments were restricted to the political and social realm. But one thing that teaching pastoral care to a diverse group of students has taught me is that the church, the body of Christ, is also entangled in the hero or villain myth. The body parts are good at talking at one another, but we struggle to talk with one another. We see our differences and forget our common humanity and grace. First Corinthians chapter 12 is a call to that work of remembering our humanity and our common grace, the work of being different and yet unified. It is an ideal to be reached for in all of our human imperfection, and certainly not something that the church or Corinth or any other church has ever fully figured out how to do. It isn't easy, and it doesn't mean that we all have to like each other, and it certainly doesn't mean that we aren't called to say hard things to one another from time to time. But we are called to try to be this one body. Because again, the world and the church officially ends when we let our beliefs conquer love. We must not let this happen. With this in mind, I wrote a story I would like to share. It is called We Can't All Be Jesus. I thought about using that as my sermon title, but had a hard time thinking of a church putting that on the front. Can't all be Jesus. I began writing the Dr. Seuss style stories when I was here. It was first part of our confirmation curriculum, and then they just kind of kept going. So with that, we can't all be Jesus. There was a community who gathered under a steeple. They were a diverse, beautiful, and unique group of people. They were apostles, prophets, and teachers. They were healers, leaders, strong people, and speakers. They were all individually members of this community, and yet one. They knew in their hearts without each, their community would be none. The members who seemed to be weak were clothed with respect. No difference in honor and care could one detect. If one member suffered, they all suffered together. Their respect and love for each other acted as a tether. But then something happened one day that changed it all. It was as if this community experienced the great fall. It was not sudden or even alarming at first. It slowly took root, and as it did, it became like a curse. People started seeing only their differences and their oneness. They began to wonder if they might be better with less. They began to divide into groups. Anyone who wanted to join them had to jump through hoops. The dividing kept going on and on. Though some suspected, nobody was willing to call the division a con. So they just kept dividing and dividing some more until the day came when the people thought the stories of community were just folklore. The groups all began to turn on each other. For those in the groups, it even became sister against brother. Soon, only two groups remained for people to belong to, villain or hero, with each sure they knew who was who. Each person thought they were the hero, each determining the other must be the zero. They were no longer able to talk. In every disagreement, they each would just walk. It was a sad thing to see the community fall in this way. It looked like they were done. A way forward? Nay. Then one day, a visitor arrived, and in him, a new hope derived. Jesus the Christ was the name he gave. He proclaimed with a smile he was there to save. Jesus invited the least of these to dinner, to dine. At parties, he turned water into wine. He made each person feel special and cared for. The community began to feel once more like the days of yore. When Jesus would teach and preach under the steeple, the community would be packed with people. Jesus could heal like no other could do. He fixed everything from people to the loo. This one time, a storm caught the community by surprise. He calmed it and caused their faith to all rise. Jesus was the most amazing person they had ever seen. Each individual wanted to sit at his feet and his wisdom to glean. But this time of unity, it seemed, could not last. And the community broke it like they would a fast. Each, it seemed, wanted to be Jesus too. Soon, another division began to ensue. Part of the community felt like they knew what it meant to be Christ. The other part screamed heresy and wanted them iced. The division once more began to grow. Once more, friend became foe. Jesus shook his head and took to the podium once more. And he asked a simple question: what is all the division for? I get it. I'm pretty awesome and great. I'm the guy you want your daughter to date. I'm perfect in every way, if truth be told. Within my being, God the Father and the Holy Spirit are rolled. I am the source of grace, truth, and light. I am the answer to your human plight. And guess what? I am but one, not many. So only I can be me. And you need to be Kenny and Martha and Chloe and David and Les. Because you can all be uniquely you, the best. There is a part of me, Jesus, in each one of you. There is also a part that God made uniquely you too. There is a piece that is the same and parts that are not. Your community is a diverse and beautiful lot. This is the way God meant for it to be. God never meant for you all to be me. Yeah, let your light shine through you and make sure that you are each the best you. But all the dividing and the labeling must end, because my name will not be used for that behavior to defend. None of you the perfect hero will be. And those villains, if given the chance, may not be so bad, you see. You are all imperfect, complex, trying your best. You succeed and mess up and love with zest. There are very few true heroes and even fewer true villains in this world. Most people are mere humans. So let your human flag unfurl. You know what makes a human truly great? When you all join your imperfections and gifts for a greater sake. When you come together, that is when you are at your best. Together, you can withstand the hardest test. Individually, you are just part of the body. Together, you form a whole that is far from shoddy. The division and labeling has made you fall, Come together as a body so you can stand tall. Rise up as a community and to your faith hold fast. Love one another and want the first to be last. Value each part as having worth in God's image. When you mess up and hurt each other, apologize and limit the damage. Life is too hard to try it alone. Life is too short to live in a safe zone. Risk a connection to another. Allow a stranger to become a sister or brother. There are many parts, but one body and spirit. Embrace your need for each other. Don't fear it. Love is the greatest gift I give to you. May it be the greatest gift you give one another too. After that, the community stayed as one. That is not to say their imperfection was done, but they realized they didn't have to be perfect to stand tall. They just needed each other, one and all. So rise up, dear body of Christ, rise up. Whenever we eat the bread and drink the cup, rise up and stand tall too. This is God's message to me and you. We are made to need one another. May we always remember, and may this knowledge our division hinder. Let us be an example of how things can be. May the body be always focused on we. In the name of the Holy Trinity, so may it be. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Loving and faithful God, our lives and the life of the world are constantly in transition. Change is weekly, if not daily, like the tides rising and falling, like the season always turning. In all the shifting transitions, we are knit together as one community in you by your Spirit. Gather us by your grace. Gather us by the grace of our Savior Jesus Christ to be one with you and with each other. Hear us now as we pray as the community of Christ with one voice. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. There are many signs we claim for our faith, but ultimately it is our act of love that reveals who we worship. This is our time to give our thanks and praise to God. May we give both our tithes and our offerings, as well as our times and talents, to the church with the expectation that they be used to further God's dreams for this world. Dear God, we live in a beautiful and hurting world. Help us to use these gifts, all of our gifts, of our talents and our time, as well as our tithes, to do your work. We commit to using these gifts in love and mercy for others. Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus' greatest gift was love given to me and you. May love be the greatest gift we give back to the world too. We are made to need one another. May we always remember, and may this knowledge our division hinder. Let us be an example of how things can be, and may the body always be focused on we. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.